players who are tall, if they know how to use it to their advantage, it can help. I mean, again, when you have a larger reach on both sides, it makes it more difficult to play in the body. I know a lot of tall players really struggle. They can play wide, but in the middle, in the body, there are areas of difficulty.
Matt, have you had a chance to see Yuki Hirano play yet this tournament?
Not so far, no.
Because it looks like they're both going to chop.
That should be an interesting match.
Hou Yingchao.
Hou Yingchao can be a little more passive when he plays. He's definitely more kind of pushed towards defense. Pretty good start so far for Japan.
Up 4-0 here. Yuki Hirano. Oh, beautiful forehand attack. Looks like he's got a lot of personality, Yuki Hirano. Really looks like he's got a lot of intensity, really into
charisma. Some of these Japanese players have a lot of explosion in their game, not just in how they play, but in character as well.
Matt, what do we know about Hou Yingchao's international experience, where he's been? Do we know a lot about him?
He was a member of the Chinese national team. As far as I know, he's playing the Polish league presently. So he's still competing in leagues. He's not competing internationally anymore. But he remains to be a professional player, and he still has a very good ability to perform in the European leagues, whether it's against Asian players, other Asian players, like players like Oh Sang-un, who've retired from the Korean national team and are still competing in European leagues, or the likes of Wang Shi, another Chinese defender that's playing German league.
There you saw, that's the first time we've seen Hou Yingchao try and attack with the forehand as opposed to blocking and pushing. Yuki Hirano with a commanding 7-2 lead here in game one. This is the second men's quarterfinals. And there's the attack again.
That had a great bite to it.
It was so linear, though. It was so direct, right?
It's concise. It's very concise. And you'll find players that play with short pips have very compact, quick strokes when they attack.
But he caught that attack, Matt, so early off the bounce, and it created this very linear, direct ball as opposed to a typical topspin ball that's going to have an arc.
Right. And especially in these conditions, that can be very difficult to play against. It seems throughout this tournament so far, the ball that people have struggled with the most is the half-long ball. I'm seeing a lot of balls kind of just coming over the edge, and people are struggling just to kind of judge the depth of the ball and also the spin, like the no-spin ball that comes half-long over the edge.
Matt, is that because the ball is not bouncing out like other balls might, other tables might, and that's why they're almost catching the ball early, if I'm not mistaken?
It's just a little bit mistimed, and they, especially when you're struggling to read the spin, it can be very hard to make. I mean, the adjustments you play with those kind of strokes are so minute and so in the moment that you make a small error, you lose the point.
So Hou Yingchao battling back here. Serves into the net. 8-6 point. I thought that was an important point that you just missed on the service. There it was. That was exactly what you were talking about. Caught the ball so early because he was expecting it to bounce out more.
That there is a ball you really have to be careful with. I mean, it's very easy to see a high ball and just in that kind of moment of excitement almost, it's very difficult to judge the spin on the ball.
Go! Go! Yeah.
I like the Hirano went forehand to backhand, almost caught Hou Yingchao. Again, he's so tall, right?
He's very. You don't see many players that height playing table tennis.
What do you think? 7'2", 7'3"? I'm joking. There we go. Yuki Hirano from Japan takes game one here in the second quarterfinals of the men's singles of the 2016 U.S. Open. I'm Gordon Kaye. I'm here with Matt Hetherington, USATT social and digital media coordinator, doing a great job. Are we up live on Facebook Live yet?
We're getting there. We're going to get up on Facebook Live. Once we can get up there, you can send through your comments, ask questions. Hopefully, we should be able to answer them. As long as they're not too technical. Regarding players' equipment, we'll do our best. But we're hoping to get that up soon. We'll
there's a reason why we're sitting up here and not playing down there, right?
That's true. Hou Yingchao's a very reliable player on results. I think one of the most, almost you could say, upsetting matches of this tournament was to see Thomas Kainath from Slovakia, who's won the US Open twice in 2009 and 2013, coming in, arriving and drawing Hou Yingchao in his first match, and just not quite being able to find rhythm to play against him or adapt to the conditions. So I mean, it's tough. You have two great players who you'd love to see work towards the final, and only one of them gets to advance.
When you're playing against a defender, we're back here in game two, excuse me. I was about to ask Matt a question. Yuki Hirano out of Japan up one game to nothing here with a 1-0 lead. When you're playing, you were talking about Thomas Kainath coming over and struggling a little bit against Yuki Hirano. Does it take you a little bit longer because of the playing conditions to adjust as opposed to when you're playing in the European League? Or?
Well, I mean, I know Thomas has kind of started transitioning a little bit more towards coaching. He has a school in Germany that he's been trying to develop. So it's difficult to stay sharp as an athlete when you're focusing more on developing other people than on yourself. But also, one of the things that stands out about a player like Thomas Kainath is that he's developed this game of really awkward-looking strokes, but he makes it work, and his whole game is kind of based on touch and feeling and just experience of playing the ball. So not only are the conditions difficult, but I imagine transitioning to the new ball has been really tough for him, being able to judge everything that's going on.
We're going to clip that one. Do you know why? Because we can.
Because we can.
2-2 here in game two.
You see a little bit of frustration there.
Again, I think he's almost saying the ball's not coming to where it should be.
That's a frustration that a lot of players share. I mean, adapting the conditions is something you have to be able to deal with. You come to an international tournament. If you go out there and you play a match early in the draw and you're finding things difficult, you've really, really got to knuckle down and try and make the right adaptations to be able to keep going. You've got a
Matt,
lot of matches.
Matt, tell me, for a player who doesn't traditionally train with a chopper like this or with a defender like this or, you know, they may not have that style of player in their inventory of training
right.
partners. How do you prepare at a tournament like this? Is it just basically working on certain things?
Well,
or?
I mean, I said in the last match, traditionally, a lot of defenders played with long pips. And it's been kind of more of a movement from Chinese players to start switching to short pimples. So I don't know what the depth of exposure to short pimples defense is from the Japanese team or the Japanese players. But, I mean, it's all down to preparation. It's how you prepare for the tournament. You see, the Chinese national team will just carry a wealth of training partners with them that are not necessarily competing in a tournament. And they will use those practice partners to prepare for matches.
It's interesting. Hirano really looks like he's struggling with his forehand now. 2 points ago, you saw him really back off in terms of the speed of his racket speed. Then the next point after that, you saw him back off and almost like be afraid to attack. And then
right.
the point after, it was three straight forehands off the end of the table.
I mean, this is the kind of thing that Hou Yingchao is really going to be trying to force. Just really upsetting the rhythm of a... I mean, they have to be able to play their forehand game. When you play a defensive player, you need your forehand. You need good footwork and positioning and timing.
And it looks like Hirano's gotten very tentative with the forehand. Almost, I'm not going to say scared, but tentative.
Well, I mean, it's a drain. A lot of the time, you need to play maybe 3, 4, 5, sometimes 10 forehands to be able to win a point against a solid defensive player. And it's frustrating to work hard to win one point and then just miss the first ball in the next point. It feels like you're kind of walking uphill, you know, 3 steps forward, or 1 step forward, 3 steps back.
Boy, Hirano looked like he was really frustrated. He's really struggling with that mid-distance forehand.
It's a mental game.
It's at least the 4th forehand he's missed this game. So Matt, great power right there is right, but how does he entice Hou Yingchao into playing his kind of game?
Well, I mean, what you've really got to do is kind of slow the play down until you get a chance to get used to the rhythm and the timing, especially where the ball's coming off the table to be able to judge the ball. You can't rush things. You've got to just work back into it. So, I mean, we've seen him miss 3, 4, 5 forehands in this match already that have made a big difference. And he's just got to bring it back into playing his game, slowing down, getting the ball on the table. And the more consistent he gets at playing forehand game, then his confidence will grow and he should be able to come back in and vary the ball more. 9-8. Personally, I would love to see this match go all the way. I mean, the longer you watch attack versus defense matches, the more entertaining they get. You really see the best out of players come out.
What a great forehand attack to tie it up at 9-9. Yeah, the last match, again, I think, Matt, you hit the nail on the head as we were prepping this match. Very similar playing styles. It looks like Hou Yingchao really has Hirano off his game, particularly with his forehand. Hirano almost looks a little confused, particularly with the mid-distance balls.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a player like Hou Yingchao, he's not quite as aggressive as a player like Wang Wei, but the range of strokes he has, his ability to vary the ball, to change the spin, to change the depth, to change his strokes.
It was such an interesting forehand. He almost guided the ball. He didn't even hit the ball. He almost guided it to the corner.
Right, and that's the kind of passive play that I'm talking about, where Wang Wei might hit a more powerful ball. Hou Yingchao is going to use his forehand to kind of change the direction of the ball or create a bounce that's a little different.
It wasn't quite a window washer, but it was like a side swipe, right?
Well, we haven't seen the hook yet. I'm still waiting for the hook. It's a well-known shot from Hou Yingchao.
Oh, caught an edge there to take game two. 12-10 in game two. We're 1-1. Very similar match so far to the Wang Wei Kenji Matsudara match. Very similar. Kenji Matsudara, number one seed, loses game one. Wins game one, comes back and loses the next four with Wang Wei. Matt, you hit the nail on the head. Very similar matches so far.
And, I mean, who's going to complain? The first match was great. This one's shaping up to be great as well.
And if I could tell you, Matt, I don't know if you can see the crowd. This place is packed.
It is.
There is not a seat to be had. Not one seat to be had. So we're coming back here to game three of the second men's quarterfinal match. Again, a reminder that all four of the men's quarterfinals will be played here on table one. All four of the women's quarterfinals will be played here on table one. And then all four of the semifinals will be played here on Table 1. So stay with us all day today here, coming to you live from Las Vegas, Nevada. This is the 2016 U.S. Open. It will be interesting, Matt, to me to see if Hirano can settle into his forehand. He really struggled in game two, four or five straight points where he wasn't sure if he was going to attack. He wasn't sure if he was going to loop. He looped long off the table. He attacked long off the table. He needs to get, as you said earlier, get settled in with the forehand.
Yeah, I'd like to see him just kind of take a little bit of pace off and just work on control and spin. Like, at the moment, we're seeing him just, it looks like he's trying to do too much. He's not quite in position. He's trying to hit through the net. One of the things that any player that plays, looks like we had a fault serve here for throwing the ball backwards.
Off his fingers, I think.
As I was saying, any person who plays against defenders knows patience is one of the most important things for the match. The biggest psychological effect from missing that many balls is that you get frustrated to a point where you kind of lose track of your game plan. Like, once he'd lost a few forehands, he kind of lost his way. And you've got to just be able to stay calm and kind of evaluate your position and try and work back towards the plan that you have for the match.
Oh, a beautiful attack there by Hou Yingchao. But Matt, if I'm not mistaken, in many respects, this is why events like the U.S. Open are good in terms of developing international competition for up-and-coming players. They're going to see a lot of styles.
That's right.
They're going to play there's the forehand again. They're going to play in a lot of style. They're going to see a lot of styles. They're going to play in different playing conditions.
And it's a contrast. I mean, the U.S. Open, there are some World Tour events on the ITTF, mainly in the Super Series, which I've competed in as well, where you're working with a straight main draw. And I think one of the great things about the U.S. Open is that it's kind of an international tournament for the people. So you can come here and you can play the Open singles. You could be a kid who's maybe 12, 13, 14 years old who's trying to develop international experience, and you could end up playing your group against a player like Hou Yingchao. And it's just a great way to get exposure to that kind of player.
But so many different styles, so many different... there it is again. He's really struggling. He's going... I don't know if he's going too forward, too up, catching the ball at the right time, but he's really struggling with that forehand loop.
I mean, the occasions where he's missing, it seems to be where he's kind of coming across towards his backhand side, the middle towards his backhand side. His body positioning is not quite... It's not quite exact in position for him to be playing against a ball that he might not be completely sure about, you know, the way it's going to bounce. He may misjudge the ball a little. But his body positioning across his backhand side on the forehand definitely needs just a little bit more work. And that's an example of a fix there.
Right, he got in good position and he drove through the ball rather than picking his body up, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, I mean, he's got to pick and choose the ball. If the ball's high or a little bit less spin, he's got to recognize that and drive forward.
Am I seeing something? Is his body coming up on the ones that he's missing? His upper body is sort of raising up?
Yeah, I mean, that's the shot I'm talking about. When he gets around on his backhand side, where the ball is going and where he thinks he's ready to hit the ball are not quite matched up. He's getting caught a little bit closer into the body, and that pulls his shoulder up.
There it is. There was the forehand. Was that quite it?
That was almost it, yeah.
Was 80% it?
That was 80. I'll take 80%. Yeah, I mean, there's some risk evaluation that he needs to put in. I mean, getting that close to the net and not being in position and trying to hit down the short side of the table down the line. It's a difficult shot when you're in position. Out of position, it can cause a lot of errors.
But Hou Yingchao set up that perfectly. Got him to pop it up. It's the first short serve that we've seen him attack like that all match. But Hou Yingchao taking an 11-5, taking a 2-1 lead here in the quarterfinals. This is the second quarterfinals match here we're playing this morning in the men's singles of the 2016 U.S. Open. We're going to take a brief break, and we'll be right back with you. Okay, here we are back in game four of the quarterfinals. Quarterfinal match number two, Hou Yingchao with a 2-1 lead over Yuki Hirano. And again, Matt, we're seeing the forehand.
He doesn't look balanced. Every time he's making that play, you can see the right side of his body coming up with the ball.
There it is again. And that time he stopped it. He did what I do all the time, stop my stroke. Right, his body's coming up, his left arm is flying out. Right?
It's kind of the wheels are set in motion for Hou Yingchao. Like, he's really started breaking down his opponent. And it gets to the point where Hou Yingchao is, he's going to be in a steady, settled rhythm where he doesn't have to attack if he doesn't want. He's winning so many points from defending here.
There it was. Is that 80% again?
Maybe 60. I mean, he can really curl the ball around sometimes.
It's incredible to watch, Matt, from this angle, because we're sitting behind it, the trajectory of the ball,
right,
and how it literally, like, it's just a nasty curveball.
But it's like we were saying in the previous match with Wong Wei. Defensive players have so many tricks up their bag. They're changing everything. Everything's just constantly changing.
Interesting that we saw Hou Yingchao attack a little bit there.
Right. I mean, if you give him the chance to attack, he's going to attack. Wow, catches the back edge.
I'll go back to it again, though. The slow Hirano's slow forehand loops look so tentative. It almost looks like, Matt, it's in his head right now. And it looks like we're streaming
looks
live
like
on
we
Facebook.
We might be live on Facebook. All right, so anybody joining us on Facebook, if you have any questions you want to throw at us, I was going to say the commentators, please feel free. We will do our best to keep up with the stream, keep up with your comments.
Wow, it was a really heavy forehand. He looked comfortable. As opposed to the ones he's missing long, he looked comfortable.
So for those of you joining us on the Facebook live stream, this is the second quarterfinal of the U.S. Open Championships men's single event. We have
a couple net balls right there.
We have a packed crowd here in Las Vegas, Nevada, in the USA.
Four, four here in game four. A lot of fours. Oh, great power right there.
I have noticed Hou Yingchao seems to be having a little bit of trouble with that side spin variation he's playing on his backhand chop. He's kind of just sending the ball long on a few occasions.
And a little bit higher.
A little bit higher.
Straight under.
But you can see what he's trying to do. He's really trying to change the placement and the spin.
So interesting watching Hou Yingchao there on that forehand, even though he missed it long. His backswing is so fluid and so long. He's so tall.
Right.
And the arm just reaches down.
You'll notice that with a lot of tall players, the likes of Samsonov, Osangun, they're taller than 6 feet, and they have such fluid games.
So Yuki Hirano here leading 6-5 in game four. Down 2-1 in games to Hou Yingchao. Got his forehand working and then caught that backhand just a little early.
So we have a question asking which rubbers Hou Yingchao is using. I don't know the brand, but he's using a short pimple rubber, I believe with no sponge. So very good for consistent defense.
Got a nice block right at the body, and then Hirano just kept pushing him wider and wider and wider till Hou Yingchao couldn't get them anymore. Couldn't get there anymore.
I mean, the more you push Hou Yingchao across from the table, the more passive he gets. But you have to be careful because the wider he goes, the more side spin's going to come back on the ball, and that really kicks away from you.
Just on that last point again, we saw him the slow loop off the table. You saw him with the slow loop off the table, Matt. He's having much more success driving through the ball
than
he is driving up on the ball and the slow loop.
That's right. I mean, I'd like when he gets that half long ball, I'd just like to see him take it a little bit earlier and drive forward. If you wait for that ball to drop, you're kind of forced to play a very vertical stroke. And if you read the spin wrong,
or if the ball doesn't come out.
That's right.
Right? And that's, as you said earlier, it's when he looks uncomfortable. And with his forehand is when he's not catching it right.
So we were just talking before, I see a comment there, we were talking before about how some of the Chinese players have started changing to short pimples. So we're starting to see this more commonly. The last round we also had Wang Wei also using short pimples. It just gives them an ability to change the spin on the ball more and be able to disguise when they change from playing heavy spin to no spin. And it gives them the range to be able to attack and block a little bit more as well.
I think the most important thing, Matt, are we going to address the most important comment so far on Facebook Live?
I am going to let you address that comment, Gordon.
My daughter is homesick. My daughter Stella is homesick and with my wife at home in Colorado, and she posted on our Facebook page, "Hi, Daddy." Like to say hi to them back home. We are here in game four. Hou Yingchao and Yuki Hirano. Hou Yingchao with a 2-1 lead, 9-9 here in the fourth game.
And he's really recognizing the importance of getting this set and being able to draw it at 2-2 so he has a chance of staying in this match.
Yeah, I think we saw earlier in the first match so to me, that point right there, Matt, was the most comfortable I think I've seen Hirano look on the forehand yet this match. Slow spinny loop into a fast driving loop. And he takes game four, 11-9 to tie it up here at 2-2. This is a best of seven quarterfinal match of the U.S. Open men's singles. We'll be back in a moment. So we're coming back live here. This is game five coming up. 2-2 match here in the second men's quarterfinals between Yuki Hirano and Hou Yingchao. Hou Yingchao out of China, Yuki Hirano from Japan. So far, this has been a fun match to watch. Both of our matches, Matt, have been a lot of fun because we've got such contrasting styles and we've got such, let's call it wily competitors, right? So
absolutely.
Wei Wang and Hou Yingchao both
Are they
considered modern defenders? Is that the word for it?
You could consider Hou Yingchao to be a little more traditional because he doesn't really have an aggressive nature about him. Whereas a player like Wang Wei, who is more, if focused on modern defense, he will actually go after the forehand. Like, he's looking for opportunities to attack. Hou Yingchao will defend, but if the opportunity is presented to him to attack, he'll take the opportunity.
It was interesting. I'm mad on that point. You saw Hou Yingchao step all the way to the forehand side of the table to play the short pips on his backhand, and he caught Hirano off guard. Again, really feel like he's struggling with the forehand. That seems to be the consistent theme of this match.
There's a lot of kind of ebbs and flows and highs and lows with playing offense against defense. I mean, Hou Yingchao's going to try again to unsettle the rhythm. It only takes a few balls or a few points to completely change the momentum of the attacking player. And once you get that kind of spurt of confidence, I mean, you saw at the end of the last set, Hirano looked so confident out there, and it just made such a huge difference to his ability to play the ball. I do have a few questions asking about the world ranking of Yuki Hirano. He doesn't appear to have a world ranking, but he has been playing in the top 12 Japanese tournaments before, so he is regarded as one of Japan's higher-rated players. But currently, as of this month, 2016, no record of a world ranking.
So we're here in game five, tied 2-2, tied 3-3.
See one question further down here. Does anybody know who the highest ranked Canadian in the tournament is? Probably Jeremy Hazen.
I believe it was too. Just a reminder, Matt, we have a great match going on here. Up next is a pair of California players, Canuck Ja and Bob Chen. Great to see, as you said earlier, 2016 Olympian Canuck Ja making it to the quarterfinals here at the U.S. Open. Bob Chen knocking off another fellow Olympian, Feng Yijun, in the last round.
And, I mean, both players in the past few months in the build-up to this tournament have had really good results. We saw Bob Chen and his team winning the YOLA North American teams, which were in Washington. And Canuck's just back from the World Juniors, where he won 10 out of his 12 matches. So
there you saw again what we've been the consistent theme through the match. When he drives through the ball with his forehand, he's having some success. When he backs off and tries the slow long loop is where he's getting into trouble.
Takes him on with the counter looping game.
It's got to be so hard to play against that style.
I mean, it's hard to play against any player of that style, but you're not just competing against style. It's also a lifetime of experience and very high level of training. Makes it very difficult to try and find ways to win.
Hou Yingchao very clearly frustrated at missing that backhand, hitting the ball up in the air. That has the live stream look on Facebook. Six, six here in game five. Let was called. 6-6 here in game five. 2-2 in games. Yuki Hirano to serve to Hou Yingchao. Oh, Hou Yingchao with a beautiful forehand attack. Really caught Yuki Hirano off guard. I think Hirano thought he was going to go back to the forehand. Just popped it right by him on the backhand. It's a beautiful attack. There it is again.
He's really got to work on getting that ball into play. We've started to see that once he gets through this kind of service receive and the kind of close table technicalities almost, once he gets into the rally and he starts building confidence, he has a much better chance of winning the point.
Well, and again, Matt, I go back to driving through the ball versus driving up on the ball. perfect example again. When he's able to drive through the ball, he's having success. When he has to drive up on the ball is where he's getting into trouble.
And it's got to be frustrating to play that many shots in a row and just work the placement, change the spin, and feel like you're almost in control, and then to just float the ball over the end at the end and lose the point.
So I would say this is probably the most important point of game five right here. Serving 7-9. He needs this point.
Absolutely.
I don't think he wants to go down 10-7 right now. Oh, net ball. Hou Yingchao almost gets it. Really nice forehand to forehand exchange there. Hou Yingchao calling a timeout here, Matt. What are they talking about right now? I mean, it seems to me that Hou Yingchao has figured out what it's going to take to win this match. Hirano, I think...
Hou Yingchao's looking steady. He looks very settled in. He seems to know what he's doing. That the pressure really is on Hirano. I mean, we've seen changes in his confidence where he's been able to play really well, and then maybe he's lost a little bit of focus or lost his way, and it's... If you were to correlate the level of confidence from Hirano and the scoreline, you would see a match, I think. I mean, the more confident he is, he's winning points. Once you see him unsettled and not as confident, he's losing points.
Matt, am I correct that for Hou Yingchao, that's more of a strategy sell yourself down discussion? For Yuki Hirano, it's more a technique issue, right? Figure out what we're doing with technique here.
It's a technical thing. It's somewhat of a mental game.
So at least on that point, it looks like the timeout has helped because it slowed down the resurgence, especially after losing that last point. So now Hou Yingchao with an opportunity to take a 3-2 lead with game point here in game five. And there it is again, Matt. The long loop off the table.
It's almost the make and break of the match. I mean, he's got a lot of other areas of the game where he seems to know what he's doing, but it keeps coming back to that half long, no spin ball, and he just keeps sending it over the end.
So we're going to take a quick break, and we'll be back in a moment with game six of this men's quarterfinals match in the 2016 U.S. Open. We're coming back live here. Game six coming up of the second quarterfinals here at the men's men's singles of the 2016 U.S. Open, live from Las Vegas. I'm Gordon Kay. I'm here with Matt Hetherington. Hou Yingchao battling back after losing game one to Japan's Yuki Hirano, has a 3-2 lead as we enter game six. Long Wei earlier advanced into the men's semifinals. Wang Wei, of course, playing out of the United States right now, not China. Hou Yingchao with a nice forehand attack to the body. You saw, Matt, Yuki Hirano's forehand out there waiting for Hou Yingchao to attack to the forehand. Instead, he went right at the body. He took something off the ball, went right at the body, and was very effective.
You can just see how much weight transfer and body work Hirano has to do when Hou Yingchao's playing the heavy ball.
Hirano takes a timeout here, very clearly frustrated with himself.
I mean, you've gone to the bench after losing the previous set. You've set out a game plan. You lose the first 3 points. When you're down 3-2, you've got to stop and you've got to just settle back in. Like, you really need to focus. You can't afford now to start a losing streak at the start of the set, which could decide the winner.
So Hou Yingchao takes a 3-0 lead here in game six, leading 3-2. The winner, of course, advancing to the semifinals, where they have an opportunity as a semifinalist to win $2,000 and the champion $4,000. So not a bad payday.
Not a bad payday at all.
There's the forehand again. Boy, Hou Yingchao is so smart in setting up his points and setting up his play, and really taking advantage of what has clearly been a struggle for Hirano. Hou Yingchao serving 4-0. And Hirano again, looping long off the table with his forehand. And that is the story of this match right now.
I mean, this is kind of, it's almost the home stretch for Hou Yingchao. To see, I mean, look at that shot, just kind of sums it up, really. It's just pure frustration. And when you've had the bench and you've come back and you've taken a lead and a timeout hasn't worked, I would say Hou Yingchao is feeling fairly confident right now that he can finish this off.
It's interesting to me on that last point, Matt. Hirano, on that last forehand loop that Hou Yingchao missed, almost didn't look like he put much spin on the ball. And Hou Yingchao was expecting more spin on that forehand than what he got.
Good to see Hirano finding some confidence.
Yeah, you get the sense that mentally he's not done yet, which is good. I mean, he was down 6-0. He's now back to 6-2 here in the sixth. Down 3-2.
It's just really slowing things down right now.
There it is. It's very intentional. Right before, he was forcing it up, and his body was flying up. Now he's almost...
The effect of that, I mean, when you play a slow ball that has less spin, is that now he's really trying to use the conditions to his advantage. If the ball doesn't bounce out, not only does it become very hard... I mean, it's hard to defend a ball that has less spin, but it's also difficult to time the counterattack from Hou Yingchao.
So now he went back to power. Now
great
he's
power.
Getting... I don't know if we're ready to say he's comfortable yet, but now he looks like he's getting a little bit more comfortable.
It's like I've been saying, throughout this match, we've just seen his confidence fluctuates so violently between being incredibly confident and just not looking like he was even in the match at all. And right now we're in a phase of an incredible amount of explosive confidence coming from him. And the scoreline shows it.
I'll remind you, he was down 6-0 here in the sixth game. His opportunity to advance on the line here. And he seems to have found the rhythm with his slope. Oh, that hit his hand. That looked like it was shaping up to be a humdinger. Ball hit his hand. So Hou Yingchao stops the bleeding, at least for the moment. Takes a 7-5 lead.
I think if Hou Yingchao can knuckle down and really mix the spin up and just stop him from this rhythm that he's in, then he'll be able to finish the match off. But at the moment, we've swayed in the way of Hirano. Hirano's looking, he has just so much momentum right now.
Hou Yingchao serving 7-6. It almost looked like he caught him off guard a little bit. He was expecting something different from the motion in the serve and got a different spin, and probably it looked, Matt, a little slower than what he was expecting. Mm. Looks like he caught it with the face open a little bit earlier.
Wow. Very explosive. I mean, all it took was a few rallies of him playing slowly and consistently to build his confidence back up in his forehand game, and now that he's found it, He's on fire.
Oh.
Just cannot make the adjustment that he needs to keep that ball on the table.
Well, but he did earlier in this game, right? And now it looks like he went back to that old habit of, well, you can't see what I'm doing at home, but that that old habit of...
He needs to take it earlier and drive through it a little bit more. If you know that the ball's going half long, you want to try and take it before it drops too low.
Well, here we are at match point, Matt. Hou Yingchao, an opportunity to close out and advance to the semifinals. And he's going to do it with a beautiful forehand kill. Hou Yingchao advances to the semifinals of the men's singles here at the U.S. Open in Las Vegas. A fun match to watch. I think frustrating in some level because you could see opportunities for Hirano to step in and do some things, but he really struggled with the slow forehand loop,
right.
Really struggled with technique, as you said earlier, footwork. He's an exceptional player, there's no doubt about it. But it looks like Hou Yingchao really just used his age and his experience and mm-hmm. really sort of sensed his advantage and really was able, Matt, to exploit that weakness when it was
Definitely. There. Definitely. And I think also Hou Yingchao was really able to remain consistent and calm, even at times when Hirano was showing a great level of confidence.
Well,